Hi there and welcome. I'm Randy Cross and this is the Randy Cross Podcast, Season 5, Episode 8. A little bit different sequence for you tonight. We do have a guest. It's going to be Rick Neuheisel, former head coach at UCLA, University of Washington, and Colorado. So he knows the Pac-12 pretty well. Also was a quarterback back in his day at UCLA and was MVP of the Rose Bowl, as a matter of fact. And is currently an analyst for CBS Sports, works on the SEC Today show on Saturdays. And he also works on Inside College Football with me on Tuesday nights. Want to remind you, if you're watching this and you're on YouTube, hit the subscribe button. Gives us an idea and who's watching, who's forwarding things, where it goes, and we can track it a lot easier that way. We'd really appreciate you hitting that subscribe button. If you're on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or any of the other social media platforms, just hit like, enjoy it, and forward it to your friends. All right? As always, a lot of sports here, a lot of college football tonight. I want to remind you, we've got 5 games this weekend. 5 games. You may not be aware that this week is when things start. They give it a weird name. It's called Week 0, which is probably because there's not many games. But our games so far this weekend are here. Here they are, coming up right now. It's Nebraska at Illinois. You've got UConn at Fresno State. You've got Hawaii at UCLA. You've got UTEP at New Mexico State. And you've got Southern Utah at San Jose State, one of the great feel-good stories of the 2020 season. Despite the pandemic, despite all the craziness they went through, the folks at San Jose State and Brent Brennan did an amazing job in 2020. So enjoy those games. Pretty good bet the home teams will do really, really well in those games, except for you got to favor Nebraska against Illinois. All right, let's get to the interview, and let's join Rick Neuheisel and see what his thoughts are, not only on those games, but on college football in 2021. So as promised, joined now by Rick Neuheisel, former head coach at UCLA, Washington, Colorado, works at CBS on the SEC, works with me on Tuesday nights on Inside College Football, and through all that part of his resume, he also managed to play quarterback at UCLA and be a Rose Bowl MVP. So welcome, Rick. Appreciate you joining me.
Randy, anytime I can hang out with a great Bruin like yourself, it's an honor.
Well, thank you. Hey, you know, we're going to talk college football. So given as this is week 0 and a pox upon whoever came up with the idea of calling something week 0 instead of week 1, our Bruins are playing. They're playing Hawaii. It's in the Rose Bowl. What do you think of our UCLA Bruins this year?
I actually am kind of long on them. I believe that Chip finally has experience. Now, whether it's big enough to play teams like LSU, which is the opponent there in week 1, we'll wait and see. But I think that they've got guys that have been in the program now for a couple of years. They've got an experienced quarterback in Dorian Thompson-Robinson, who's back with the team now practicing. I think this is a year where Chip's going to make some hay. Unfortunately, as things can happen, it's a very tough schedule. I mean, they draw Oregon and Washington from the north side of the Pac-12 instead of Oregon State and Washington State, which will be the on the schedule of USC. They have LSU, aforementioned, as a non-conference opponent in the Rose Bowl on September 4th. So those three games are very difficult because all three are top 20 teams to start the season. But I do believe they'll be over the 500 mark. I think they'll get to postseason. And my hope is that they'll knock off one or more of those three marquee opponents and get Bruin fans back excited about college football again.
I sure hope so. It's about time. It's actually about time that the Pac-12 in general got at least a participation trophy, because It hasn't been real pretty out there of late. Along the lines of all that, with the Pac-12 and then the Big Ten and the ACC, I was so excited. They had this big announcement. It was kind of pitched as being something that was going to be rather epic.
Historic.
It was over in about 90 seconds. When the press release is longer than the actual event, it tells you that it was kind of a non-event. But what did you make of that whole announcement with the Alliance? Is that just them sort of giving some people a heads up on, you know, you've been warned or what?
Well, first off, having coached in the Alliance of American Football, let's hope this alliance lasts longer than that particular alliance did.
True.
Listen, they kind of booked it and billed it as a historic announcement, and it was much ado about very little, only because there are no contracts. There are no written documents. They are basically counting on 41 different institutions saying, oh, sure, we'll go along with that. But no blowback to the institution should they decide to do otherwise. And if we look at Texas and Oklahoma right now, while there are some that are still angry that they made the moves they did, we can all understand why they did it. And so too would we feel about anyone in the 41 that broke ranks and decided to go where there was a real pot of gold for their particular institution. That being said, I do think it was in some ways an attempt to be a de facto embargo against the SEC. It was clearly, hey, look, we understand that you guys are the power mongers right now. You're going to command the most dollars, and you have the ability now to take us all out. But bonded together, Big Ten, ACC, Pac-12, we have a voting block that can keep this Pac-12 or keep this college football playoff thing from going through as advertised. We can hold back the reins there. We can wait for more television suitors to get involved in the college football playoff bidding war, to go forward with the proposal that was put forth by Greg Sankey and Bob Bowlesby and Jack Swarbrick and Craig Thompson, the commissioner of the Mountain West. That was all going to happen almost in September, Randy. And if that, right. If they would have ratified that, thank goodness the Houston Chronicle kind of outed the deal that was going to be Texas and Oklahoma headed to the SEC, because by knowing it, everybody kind of pumps the brakes on such a thing. And that's in some ways power that's being held in the hands of these three brand new commissioners. And then the other thing I think that is going to happen is when both the Big Ten and Pac-12 go to market, I'm not sure when the ACC goes to market to get their new television deal. This idea of a scheduling alliance, especially as we'll learn more details of a scheduling alliance, will be a lucrative thing for them to show these different suitors, you know, hey, this is why you should come and bid on us and give us a handsome payday. So there is, as much as there wasn't exactly the big bang, it certainly changed the world of college athletics as we see it. You know, it was definitely foreseen that they were going to talk about the college model. We're going to try to hang on to the college model. We like student athletes. We're going to try to, you know, make it about academics, knowing that the NFL can only house 2% of this workforce, right? We need to keep this model. And I thought it was interesting that Greg Sankey followed suit by saying he wants to keep the model too. No problem. We want certainly to make for the best possible student athlete experience and look forward to collaborating with our fellow conferences. So a big announcement about very little, you know, the Seinfeld, you know, show about nothing. It was very much kind of that way. But I still think that there was power and strength. The thing that I found interesting, Jim Phillips from the ACC said how important the Big 12 and the remaining Big 12 is to these guys. Randy, they could easily incorporate the 8 floundering programs right now. Right. Four could go to the Pac-12. 2 could go to the ACC, assuming West Virginia would be one of them. And 2 could go to the Big 10, and you'd have 4 16-team conferences that all have now done exactly what they said, mean kumbaya to this model. And you wouldn't have anybody sitting there adrift, but that wasn't part of the announcement.
Well, one of the other parts of college football for 2021 offseason and the slow news period was all this work with name, image, and likeness.
Right.
Which really seemed to, I think, to a lot of people, get off to a rousing start when Nick Saban happened to mention at the SEC meetings that his quarterback was had like a seven-figure deal for the NIL contribution. And it was like, oh, okay. So I guess that was an official recruiting.
Actually, Randy, he did even better than that. He said at the SEC meetings he didn't mean to say it publicly. But what he did is he said it at the San Antonio, Texas High School Coaches Convention. High school coaches. And you don't think they're, as you and I both know, Lord Saban doesn't say anything he doesn't mean to say. So he wanted those high school coaches to know that there were riches if those kids playing in the great state of Texas found their way to Tuscaloosa.
I loved it. I love it. Hey, overall, besides our Bruins in week zero, any other games that kind of catch you? I know you've got a little bit of a connection to that Southern Utah San Jose State game.
Well, that one's interesting, and we'll talk about that one first. That one's interesting because Southern Utah visiting San Jose State, Brent Brennan, of course, another UCLA Bruin like you and I, played for me as a wide receiver during his time there at UCLA. I love Brent. He did a great job. Mountain West champs a year ago in a very difficult pandemic-ridden year. But what's interesting about that game is they get a tune-up because the next week they go to the Coliseum to play the Trojans. And they have almost everybody back from a very, very good Mountain West team from a year ago, one that, you know, completely changed the fortunes of the San Jose State program. So they're going to have a lot of confidence. They've got Nick Starkel at quarterback, the kid that started at A&M, went to Arkansas, and then finally found a great home there in San Jose. So that's an interesting game just because if the Spartans get out of the blocks looking the part, then all of a sudden Clay Helton and company may have their hands full. Because remember, as good as the Trojans are with their quarterback and throw game, and I know you as a former center will always look at this number, they averaged 3 yards a carry last year and had less than 100 yards a game. You cannot win big championships. And I know this is, you know, poison in the ears of Trojan fans. You cannot win big championships if you can't run the ball. You have, and if you choose not to run the ball because the numbers say you shouldn't, that's okay. But your yards per carry has got to be higher than 3. And and we'll just wait and see, because that San Jose State USC game will be one that might be on upset alert. The other game that I'm really excited about this weekend, maybe the marquee game, if you're not a Bruin fan, is Nebraska traveling to Illinois. Complete evolution of the analyst. Everybody is having analysts do coaching duties. I have been on too many practice fields in my life in the last 5 years and watched the analyst, and you can't pick out who's an analyst and who's not. I mean, everybody's just coaching football. And I'm okay with it. As long as everybody, what's good for the goose is good for the gander, no worries. And more coaches coaching. But you've got head coaches in all these different campuses, former head coaches, and you're expecting them to go out there and say nothing? That's impossible. I mean, we can't do it. We're going to be involved in something, especially when a question is asked of us. And so Scott Frost and somebody on his staff was given some video. But the question isn't whether or not they did it, because he's guilty and they're guilty. The question is who turned in the film. And I think that's the bigger story, because if it's an insider and this is a coup to end run Scott Frost, a favorite son of Nebraska, then I think it's a big story. Because Scott Frost came with all this aplomb, having had the perfect season at UCF, 13-0. They had the mythical national championship celebration at Disney World right there in Orlando. Then he leaves. He's on a $5 million a gig. They struggle early. Bill Moose re-ups him, saying, no, this is our guy. Bill Moose is gone over the summer, which gives you a little bit of suspicion as to what the motivations are here. And now Scott Frost is under a little bit of a microscope with an NCAA investigation. That, to me, sounds like an inside job. And so I'm curious to watch Nebraska, how they respond to that from does it distract them in the field of play? And on the other sidelines, another great story in Brett Bielema returning to college football. You know, I was doing the Arkansas-Missouri game in Arkansas, when I was handed a press release as the gun sounded to end the game. Handed a press release that Brett Bielema had been released. Randy, he hadn't even gotten off the field. And I had the press release that it was over. We kind of knew it was because Jeff Long had basically fallen on the sword, the former athletic director there, in defense of Brett Bielema. But since that time, he's been in the Siberia of New England, just studying at the sensei Bill Belichick's feet. And so now he gets another chance to go back to his beloved Big Ten. Remember, he was the head coach at Wisconsin and had three Rose Bowl teams. So, and he's in the same West Division. So I think it's an exciting time for Brett Bielema to be back as a head coach. And I think the Illini fans will give him a rousing ovation to begin the season. And we're going to get to see a crowd. We're going to get to see a crowd, which obviously is a huge thing headed into 2021. I know there's some trepidation with the variants and all the different stuff going on with vaccines or no vaccines. But at day's end, Nebraska at Illinois will be a fun game to watch.
Yeah, I tell you another one, and it's to me, it's the sort of the semi-official big game kickoff of 2021, that Clemson-Georgia game in Charlotte. And it'll be a full house. They'll all be masked up, but it'll be a full house in Charlotte, and it should be unbelievably entertaining.
Oh.
Now, Georgia fans are, you know, rightfully so, very enthusiastic about JT Daniels. They're very enthusiastic about their defense. I don't understand, in some cases, the way they kind of short sell Uyunglele about how he's pretty inexperienced. Well, he did okay at Notre Dame.
400, just 400 yards.
Yeah, but that game to me is going to tell us a lot about what kind of a season, not only for those two teams, but just in general, because I really think it's going to be an amazing football season.
This is the marquee game. There's no question it's the marquee matchup. And as we just talked about the Alliance, it's one of those things that you wonder down the road, is it going to happen? Because if there's a, you know, de facto lockout of the SEC, Clemson can't play Georgia. Now, they can if it's already in the contract, right? They've been clear on any existing contracts are all set. But down the road, those weeks will be spoken for by Big Ten or Pac-12 teams, according to the three new commissioners. And we'll see what eventually comes from that. It may just be an advertisement to potential television suitors. But an interesting game. You mentioned JT Daniels. He's the kid who transferred to Georgia from USC, having lost his job when he got a knee injury, and Keaton Slovis came on the scene and became a star there for the Trojans. I got to meet him at the SEC Media Days. I really like him. He had a lot of Joe Burrow in him, you know, in terms of his intellect, his dry sense of humor. I can't wait to watch him play. I know Darnell Washington probably won't be in the game. He's got a foot injury and has been ruled out. And that's a hit, the big tight end. But there's enough going on in Georgia's offense that Todd Monken can get to him some open receivers to throw to. This is going to be about Clemson's pass rush to me. Can Clemson's pass rush dominate the game, get JT Daniels off balance and make it a long night for him? If they can, I think Clemson wins. If they can't, I don't, you know, having watched Clemson practice, and I was given that opportunity and loved it, going through their facility, it's second to none. It's just a beautiful, beautiful place, and Dabo has certainly recruited his tail off. But I didn't see a bell cow out there to replace Travis Etienne. Now, it may be that it was just a slower day and, you know, the offensive line wasn't having a great day. So certainly don't take anything personally. I know they've got a host of depth for that position. But if Georgia can keep that running game down and put the pressure all on a youngster in terms of experience in Uyunglele, or as I like to call him, Uy, I'm leaving L.A., because he's a Los Angeles kid, Randy, just like you, that just came totally to the South, right? But if they can make him one-dimensional, then I think Georgia has a chance to win that game.
If you had to pick, not even a wild card, but I mean, from a Heisman standpoint, can we see a sort of rags to riches in this year? It seems like there's a guy that comes out of, not that he's unknown,
right,
But, you know, with
like,
some like of these
Joe
big
Burrow,
offenses.
Like Joe Burrow, who was.
Like Joe Burrow did
yeah,
at LSU.
He had to leave. He couldn't play at his own school. Well, JT Daniels comes to mind. I just said I felt I saw a little of him. If JT Daniels
Will Kirby cut him loose, Rick?
I think he has to. I mean, yeah. If you really are studying history, you're studying the guy that, you know, gave you this absolute platform to get one of the coveted jobs in all of the land, let alone college football, that being the head coach at Georgia, then you should be studying Nick Saban. Nick Saban, you know, won with A.J. McCarron. He won with, Greg McElroy. And that's no offense to either one of those guys. But then he realized at halftime of a Georgia game in the Mercedes Dome that he better change. And he went with a kid that all of a sudden whipped it around the yard, right? And Tua, Tagovailoa, and a legend was born. And the RPO was born. And all of a sudden, hey, we better go get a bunch of fast receivers. And four first-rounders later, here they are. If you don't realize you got to keep up with everybody, and after, you know, Georgia saw LSU firsthand with Joe Burrow, they need to see that we have to change. And I think Tom Monken's going to get the handcuffs off. The question is, do they have enough depth at wide receiver and tight end? Arik Gilbert, this kid that was transferred there, is gone for personal reasons. I don't know if he's ever, and we wish him nothing but the best in handling whatever it is that ails him. But I just don't know that they have the same weaponry that we had at LSU when Burrow was there, or at Alabama when Mac Jones or Tua was there. Wait and see.
Cannot wait to see. It's going to be fantastic. Inside College Football, our crew is back starting next Tuesday night. And SEC, your show, are they back on 9/11?
We have a preview show on Saturday, August 28th at 2:30 Eastern. And then we get to do the halftime of the Fresno State-UConn game back there in Fresno to open the season. Another week zero tilt. By the way, wish there Randy Edsall well. That's a team that has gone from, you know, going to the Fiesta Bowl and, you know, being kind of the toast of the town to now a team that's basically looking for a game. And it's one of the talk about, you know, realignment and so forth, teams gerrymandering conferences and such. There are winners and there are losers. And Connecticut, unfortunately, was a loser. So they're traveling all around. I think they have a game late in November against Clemson. So that'll be fun for Randy.
I've got them in week two with Brahm and Purdue coming into town.
Well, there you go. So it's an interesting run for Randy. I would say this, though. If you have been a coach long enough to get over 100 losses and Randy has them, you can coach. Because they can find lots of guys that will try it. But if you keep a guy that's already lost 100 times, you're either a good guy, a great coach, or both. That's a fact.
Yeah. Or you got pictures.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right, Rick. Hey, thanks a lot. Look forward to seeing you next week.
Randy, I can't wait. Inside College Football is the best show on television. It's good fun with all of us, and we get to talk about it all in long form, as you and I both absolutely require.
All right, now, enjoy, and keep up that par shooting.
I'll do it, my friend. Take care. And by the way, I like the beard. The beard just definitely good on you.
Yeah, you know, I think it's going to stick around. I think I'm going to keep it for the long haul.
All right, Chris Kringle. You take care.
Yeah. All right, man. Talk to you later. All right. Thank you, Rick. As usual, home run. He's real good. You know, his quarterbacks are like that. They handle that media stuff pretty well. Want to remind you where to catch him. You catch him on Saturdays on CBS and Tuesday nights on CBS Sports Network on Inside College Football, which is where I happen to be also on Tuesday nights. All right. Right now, let's hit a little Randy Eats.
It doesn't matter if it's boiled or fried, just eat it, just eat it, just eat it, just eat it.
Okay, it's been a couple weeks. I thought I'd share, torture you a little bit and share some of the stuff I did on my Kamado Joe, some of the smoking I was doing. Pretty crazy. I mean, the ribs, for instance, that I did, I'm showing here first. You know, I use the 3-2-1 method. That's 3 hours unwrapped, 2 hours wrapped, and 1 hour then just glazed up at a low temperature. They came out pretty special. The next thing from about a week ago was bacon wrapped, and I'm talking about that big old thick bacon you can get at Costco. I got a big package of the chicken thighs, took the skin off it, double wrapped it, so two pieces of bacon on every chicken thigh. Some, you know, get some toothpicks in there, hold it all together. That was pretty stellar. It was, if I don't mind saying so myself, the chicken, the bacon wrapped chicken was very good. The next one up was about a week and a half ago. I did some brisket. I did a great big old brisket. It was about a 20 pounder. And you see from the cross section I did, it had a good amount of marbling in the middle, but the meat itself just juicy as heck. And then you got a picture there. The next one of the brisket is the brisket when it was all together. So it started at 20. By the time it cooked out and rendered, probably about 15 pounds, but I've still got about 5 pounds sitting in the freezer upstairs. And the last thing is kind of the holy grail of barbecuing and smoking, and that's pork belly. Yeah, I know, there's fat in pork belly, duh. It's basically thick cut bacon, but this pork belly was epic. And I did that 2 weeks ago, right after I did my last show. This coming Sunday, I'm doing pork belly, but I'm going to cube it and do what I call carnivore candy, where you slow cook it and you get the sauce and you get the brown sugar, and I'll take plenty of pictures. You'll see some of that next time we meet.
It doesn't matter if it's boiled or fried.
Okay, let's go on to social media and where you found us. Want to remind you, YouTube equals subscribe. But Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, the rest of them, please hit like, leave a presence. Let us know you were there. All right? That's very, very important to us. And it enables us to track and enables us to do a lot of stuff about who's watching what episodes and what exactly in the episodes you all liked. So please do that for us. And as always, randycross.com is the most convenient way to find this podcast. randycross.com. All right, time now to head on out of here. And as we do every week when we leave, it's with some form of a happy trails.